Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
How's everyone doing? Hot Friday. Woohoo. Give people a bit more time to join. Thanks for being here today, everybody. We can get started, and then as people join, we'll just keep moving. So the focus of today's call, start moving through, like using these summits as a place to kind of start moving through some of the work that's coming out of Haas, and using this time to just like talk through some of the nitty gritty of the elements and other things that we're working on. We now have a Haas website, which is really exciting. And if folks haven't seen that, maybe Casey can put that in the chat. Check that out. And you know, with everything with this project, it really is very much like a group think project. So if you ever have any feedback or anything that you have questions about, feel free to just message us or bring them to these calls. So today we were going to talk through what we mean by the shelter being reserved for animals that really need sheltering. But I think if it's a small enough group, we can really just talk through other topics too. We don't want to just dominate or dictate the conversation with all of you. We have our instructors on the call today also. So I guess I'm just wondering from all of you who are on the call, are you operating normally, or where are you in terms of like operating at the shelter or shelters that you work with? Has intake gone back up?
Hi, it's Stephanie, and I'm in Brampton, Ontario, Canada. We are still operating basically closed to intake of owner surrenders or stray cats. We've always taken in stray dogs just because we're a big city and we're worried about traffic issues and that sort of thing. So we've maintained that throughout. Our population's quite low, and we're still operating with two separate teams for safety COVID-wise. And in Ontario, our area, because we're part of the Greater Toronto Area, was one of the last to open up to the second stage of operations because we had the highest case numbers due to population. So we've just moved into that this week. So businesses are starting to reopen.
Thank you, Stephanie, for sharing. And intake anywhere else, like what is happening sort of like with intake, and is there sort of like a reserve for animals that really truly need shelter? And does that, when we say that, are we clear enough? Like, are there questions in the community about what that means, or are we being clear enough with that? Or are there ways we could be defining that better?
I think that, in our community intake, it went down slightly, but I don't, like, for us, we've always just taken in what really needs to come in. And so that hasn't changed much. We're actually on pace to bring in more animals than we did last year or historically. but our community was underserviced before, so that doesn't really surprise me. I do think messaging overall, I think our communities just need to know that, know what that means, what truly is in need versus what's a convenient, healthy stray pickup, you know? And it's, and I think it's just us messaging that to our communities, saying, you know, that that animal could be just blocks away from its house. If you bring it into us, it's much further away.
Jamie, in St. Louis, are you all getting any pushback from the community about that? Feeling like there will be more loose dogs or injured cats on the street or anything like that?
No, I haven't looked at, I haven't like felt out the, you know, we're on the other side of the river. And I want to say that if I haven't heard anything, then no, but I don't know exactly like what St. Louis City is doing. I know that they still have animals, they're still reaching out regularly for fosters to take and, you know, people to step up to come walk dogs and things like that. So I don't know that they're necessarily as low as they had been before. But I haven't really heard much pushback though either, especially in our community. And I would think that we would have heard something by now. I think it's slower, but I haven't heard much, which I think is a good thing.
It's a really good question. I'm curious if other people are experiencing any pushback or hearing anything in their communities about the HOS model, or any of the changes that are being made in your community. And I guess I also am curious, like if folks are, folks on this call are making changes with the HOS model too. I recognize a lot of your names, obviously, but. Summer, what's going on in Hawaii?
So Hawaii is a little unique because we did not have a lot of effect from COVID in terms of cases with for humans, but we, you know, we followed all the best practices. So we are starting to reopen for services, and we are seeing intakes going up for sure. Still not as dramatic as the numbers that we saw coming in this time last year, so that's good. But they have increased significantly since the height of quarantine for us. But, you know, the community was very eager for us to reopen services so that they could bring in animals. And so we are seeing a huge increase in, you know, healthy stray animals coming in, mostly cats. We're not seeing a significant number of dogs coming in right now. We actually can't meet the demand for people wanting to adopt dogs here on Oahu. That's not necessarily the case for some of our neighbor islands, but cats for sure. So that's sort of where we're at right now.
Interesting. Does anyone else have anything to share on that note? Instructors, I'm curious, any questions that you all have like on these topics or, you know, for the folks on the call, any other questions?
Well, I know it's hard to know if no news is good news or is no news bad news, because it can go either way. So that's always something that I feel like we should be worried about. No news tends to be good news, except in animal welfare. Sometimes it could be really, really, really bad news.
Yeah, that's a good point. And how many folks on this call, I guess we could use like the reactions or something, are involved in either tier one or tier two with the Haas model? Or in working groups? Stephanie, I know Summer is, but I think you called in. Erica, where are you from?
Tallahassee, Florida, home of 9,000 cases today.
Wild. What's going on there? What's your role in your organization?
I'm actually the director, we're a pretty small town, so we only have about 200,000 people, but 50 cases for us in a day was a massive uptick for us. For the most part, it's been South Florida, but now it's spreading up through Florida because of all the amusement parks being open and that kind of thing. But we've been doing pretty good. No complaints.
How are your staff feeling about coming in and working as essential workers? Are you getting any pushback or any concerns from them?
We're still on the A and B teams. And so that was really important. Actually, it was before we had a big surge in cases, and we've seen an uptick in Florida in general in the last 2 weeks, but we had a big surge in cases last Friday. And ironically, we had just changed schedules starting Saturday, but we had a lot of pressure from the rest of our municipality to essentially combine all of our staff. So it was kind of interesting that that I pushed back and I said, no, not yet. And now the state is seeing massive increases in just a week's time. So we've been very fortunate in that regard. But we've been obviously by appointment only, but we've had to expand our appointments. So we are actually have appointments now, more hours that we have staff at the shelter and more hours for appointments than we were ever open. We used to be closed one day a week. We had shorter hours on the weekends, and now we're 10 to 6:30 every single day of the week just to meet the demand. And that's both for intakes in terms of getting animals scanned and people bringing in sick and injured, healthy stray dogs, and adoptions as well. So we've been pretty steady. We also offer owner request euthanasias, and that's gone up. And I think it was you that posted about having parvo, and we've definitely seen a lot of parvo this season, a lot more than normal, and a lot of adult dogs with parvo.
Yeah, it's interesting. We saw in the last 7 days or so, parvo has just exploded. We didn't see any when we typically see the beginning of parvo season, the beginning of spring. But it's making up for it right now. It's crazy. We're struggling.
So interesting. So is it more now, or is it going to look like more overall for the season?
I think for us, it'll still be, well, probably, it might still be down. I don't know, because we do get spikes a couple times a year. It's just we're trying to, I mean, the rain definitely seems to not help, but we're just trying to figure out, like, is it because people are taking their new puppies places and they're just getting out more? I don't know.
So this is a question that we had talked about at the beginning of COVID. Those of us on the cat scene, we were wondering if COVID is going to, if we're going to see effects raising our Panloop rates because we're not out there TNRing and SNRing so many cats coming in over the counter. Is anybody seeing spikes in Panloop along the same way you're seeing spikes in parvo? Nobody yet? Well, that's good news if we're not, right? But that's something that's been in the back of our cat minds since the beginning of COVID, that are we going to see Panloop skyrocket now?
Someone mentioned on the morning call that they were seeing more Panloop today, I think, on the morning call. I can't keep
calls straight. It was today. Yeah, and I don't think, I've talked to a couple shelters around Texas that are seeing Panloop, but they're not seeing an increase in Panloop. It's not more than usual, which is good.
Yeah, I'm certainly hoping so, given that, you know, the vaccine works so good and we're the effects of COVID on TNR, we know, are not going to be as disastrous as we had feared. But it's still been in the back of my head that I've kind of watched when I see Panluke pop up in my email inbox. It's still something I'm keeping an eye on. So I'm glad to hear that none of you guys, especially Erica, you and Tallahassee and whatnot, you're not seeing any spike where you're at.
Erica, why do you think you're seeing an increase in owner request euthanasia?
Honestly, for a couple of, oops, hold on a second.
Can I just jump in and ask those shelters that are seeing a lot of parvo cases? I've seen on some of the groups and message boards that there some shelters are having success with treating these animals in like a foster situation, because we had a litter found this spring with parvo, and they were all hospitalized at a referral hospital, and we spent a ton of money out of our hope fund to help care for them. So those of you that are seeing it a lot, are you treating them, and are you having success not having them hospitalized?
So at Austin Pets Live, we almost prefer foster homes for a lot of the cases. If they need to be hospitalized, if they're super sick and just having the blowout diarrhea, then those guys we do hospitalize because they tend to do better. But for the ones that are mild to moderately sick, if we can get them into a foster home, we see that they do better just because they're in more of, I mean, obviously we tell them to still kind of section them off somewhere, but they're in more of a home environment. They get more attention, they get more TLC. So we do see a pretty successful treatment in foster for sure. And we, the last time we did a big plea at the beginning of COVID to get parvo puppies into foster homes, we saw a really great response from medical fosters to take them in.
We do foster for Panluke kittens too.
Yes, absolutely. Ideally, Panluke kittens go straight into foster, regardless of how sick they are, just because they 100% of the time do better in foster.
Does anybody on the call have parvo programs but not Panluke programs? This is one of Jordana's favorite questions to ask. I stole it from her.
It's surprising how many shelters treat parvo, but they don't treat Panluke because they think they're just not savable or they're too hard to treat, when it's really not, they're almost easier to treat. So I'm always surprised to see how many shelters treat parvo, but then they euthanize all of their Panluke kittens.
Jamie, why are you guys not treating Panluke?
We just don't see it. Is the only thing. We're just now getting into like cats and kittens. So, but we used to, I mean, in our community 5 years ago, that was all we had were puppies just coming out of our community, born in under abandoned houses. And we could target the neighborhoods that they came from. And we knew that if kitten puppies were born in this area of the city, they were probably going to have parvo because it was just rampant, and it, you know, it's not dying in the environment. So every single one of our parvo puppies, unless it had to be hospitalized because it was in critical condition, went to a foster. Every single one. We never ever kept them in the shelter.
If you had a Panluke come in right now, you'd probably treat it though, right? Like, it's not that you don't treat them, you just don't have any.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
Jamie knows she better say yes to
that. I know.
Question.
I'm like, Jamie?
Even if the answer was no, she'd say yes.
She's got all the instructors staring at her. She's like, uh-oh.
And we have protocol. Like, we have a lot of protocols and things that we can share for all of these programs if you're interested. And they live on our website as well. If you're interested to see the foster protocols and like Jordana was saying, like when they stay in the hospital versus when they go to foster and all of that, we have documentation for. So I'll send that over to you, Stephanie, for sure. If anyone else wants it, if you wanna put your email in the chat, I'll send a bulk email out.
I also have, we have our Parvo Wiki site that I'm gonna put in the chat for everyone. It has all things Parvo. So I'll just leave that in there and you guys can go through it. It's a ton of information.
And I just wanted to also say that kittens are also cheaper to treat than puppies too, because you're giving little bitty tiny amounts of meds, so it spreads out a lot longer.
So, yeah, and we don't, not to just go off on a total Panluc tangent, but we also don't put catheters in any of our Panluc patients. We experimented with IV catheters and they just didn't seem to increase their survival rate. What they really need is force feeding, warmth, love, all of that kind of husbandry stuff, and the IV fluids just don't seem to help them. So we go with straight sub-Q treatment on our Panluc kittens and provide them with the force feeding and that sort of stuff that they need.
Interesting. I'm so curious to see, like, you know, as intake is going down, is there going to be, are shelters going to feel like they have larger capacity to deal with some of these cases that they didn't previously? Like, is that true for any of you in Florida or Hawaii, like as intake has gone, or wherever, like as intake has gone down, have you been able to treat more animals?
I think for us in Hawaii, on my island, in Oahu, I think we have been able to treat more animals. I think we, compared to many shelters on the mainland, though, like, that looks super different for us. So, for example, we've just started neonatal fostering for the first time and trying to even for younger kittens that had, you know, ringworm or upper respiratory, like treating those. FIV and FELV, we're just starting to work with those cats as well in terms of life saving. So it's been primarily focused on cats. So I think it's a little behind the curve of some other shelters, but we have been able to turn more of our attention towards those populations now.
That's fantastic.
I know I'm getting a lot more on the sort of behavior side and enrichment side. I'm getting a lot more questions and inquiries about building volunteer dog walking programs. Not that we can have a ton of volunteers on campus, but it seems like a lot of groups are sort of preparing for that or doing like at home enrichment, increasing, you know, the number of times dogs are getting out of their kennels every day because they're not so burdened with just the masses. They can actually focus a little bit on those guys that need special need. That's a huge generalization. It just seems like I'm getting more of that, but I know not every shelter is at that place right now.
I think that's been our biggest change too, is because our population is lower and we have a lot more animals in foster care, that we've been really able to focus on the enrichment of the dogs. And because of the small population, our dogs are getting out several times a day and they're getting a lot more mental stimulation than just doing play groups and a walk and a little bit of training here and there. So that's what we've seen as the biggest improvement. But I was sorry about the running out of the screen there a little while ago. One of my dogs halfway fell in the pool while barking to the neighbor dog. So go
for it. Oh, no.
So I'm sure that didn't look graceful. But as far as owner requests that you guys had asked me about, I can't really say why owner request euthanasias has gone up. I think it's just one of those freak things that I don't know if people are sitting at home staring at a sick animal or what the situation may be. It just seems really unusual that we've seen that increase. And they haven't been, we do, I would say about 50-50 between aggression cases and end of life issues, but almost all of them have been end of life issues. And some of them have even passed before their appointment that we had scheduled for the following day. Obviously we, you know, we can schedule them same day, but some people just want time and that kind of thing. So I can't really say. Some of those have been parvo cases. That were just too far gone as well. but it doesn't seem to be any one thing that's driving that.
Interesting. Is anyone else seeing that?
I would say less people are getting vet care right now in general because they can't just walk into a vet and get vaccines. They don't like the idea of drop-off. So even the best of owners are avoiding that care. And we've definitely had a lot of conversation about the aspect of, in the Haas model, of providing more wellness for our community. Right now, we only do once a month rabies and microchip clinics, and we haven't been able to do that during COVID. And so now we're going, maybe we need to add FRCP and DA2PP to those clinics as well, at least some effort to get in that right direction.
Yeah, and hopefully we can get vets on board with that and not get pushback from the local vet community. Because that really is the biggest barrier with being able to provide that care is that regular practice clinics are not very fond of that idea, even though we know that most animals aren't going to get that care if they don't get it for free or for as low cost as possible because they don't have the means to. So there has to be another option for them.
Faith, what did they do in El Paso? They just had like a drive-through vaccine clinic, right? And it was like 12 miles or something of cars.
Yeah, and actually, Kim is on this call, but Kim and I are doing a microchip clinic on Sunday this week, too, with Pflugerville Pets Alive. But yeah, in El Paso, they drove through. They actually, the first person in line started lining up at 10:30 p.m. the night before, even. And they did vaccine, microchip, and also big bags of food for every person that came, cat or dog. And if it was a cat, they kept him in the car in the carrier. If it was a dog, they had somebody that was holding the leash, walked him over, did the vaccine real fast, put him back in the car. So there's very limited social contact at all.
Faith, do you know, was it just rabies or did they do distemper parvo FRCP too?
They did the DAPP and FRCPs.
Do you know if they got any pushback on that?
They didn't get any pushback. Paula received a huge grant from Petco for vaccines. Like, she has $25,000 she has to spend by the end of June. So she's got 4 more days left at it. We've been spending. She's even been able to give vaccines out to rescue groups to be able to use on the animals that they're taking instead of them coming to the shelter. They got no pushback on it.
Okay.
And they're actually even still, I mean, even today, while I was talking to Paula, she's driving around, they're doing doorstop vaccines for their fosters too. So she was doing director day, it was her turn. So she was driving around town vaccinating fosters that are at home right now.
We have 2 drive-in clinics, drive-through clinics in July, and that's scary now.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to lie. I'm a little nervous about Sunday, you know, but Kim is great and has plotted everything out, and we have a very big open drive-through space, and me and the person that will be holding for me are close friends, and so we'll be in a room together with masks on and stuff like that, and then we'll have somebody else that's opening the handles and the doors and stuff like that. That's all they're doing. They're not touching anybody else. And then somebody else bringing the animals in on the leash or in the carrier. So, I mean, we're doing all that we can think of to try to be as safe as possible. Of course, there'll be hand sanitizer everywhere. Kim bought the masks and the face shields. So we'll have the face shields also. So, I mean, I feel like we're going to be pretty safe. And at this point, we need to start getting some animals chipped and vaccinated to, you know, try to stay ahead.
How did you work it out with the cats how did you work it out with the cats? I know we were talking about that, how to do the cats in the car.
They're going to be carried in a carrier.
They're going to come inside?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the chippers are going to be inside. That way we don't have any risk of anybody getting loose in the parking lot and taking off. And she's also doing online registration ahead of time, so paperwork is done ahead of time. Right now, we only have 1 cat signed up, and or at least the last email that I saw, we had 1 cat sign up and 17 dogs. Kim is on here. She can definitely talk more.
We're up to 4 cats. We're up to 4 cats and 27 dogs. Yay. And there's a handful of people that hadn't filled out information yet. So we're getting there. Still very small, but hopefully doable.
That's fantastic. We're going to share in the chat. We have a blog about drive-through clinics, and it has some resources so that you don't have to reinvent the wheel. You can just grab our the spreadsheets that Pima made and look at their plans that they put together. Casey just shared that in chat. Thanks, Casey. I love how creative COVID has forced all of us to be. You know, it's so interesting. Like, we're just having to come up with these new solutions. Who knew?
Where should we shift gears and do the kind of introduction of Haas and maybe the myths and facts to prep us for the future summits of discussion about the elements of Haas and stuff?
Sure, yeah, that sounds great. Thanks, Faith. Unless anyone else has anything that they wanted to sort of share about on these topics or anything that they're concerned about in their communities before we move on. See, we have Kathy Duncan who just joined us as well. Hi.
Hi, everybody.
Hi.
How are you doing?
Oh, Stephanie's on the call too, thank God. It's been an interesting week. We met with staff yesterday after the press release came out. And so there was an awful lot of fear mongering about how we're only going to need half the staff to do this. So yeah, it's been kind of a tough day or two, but yeah, we'll get through it. And thankfully I have people like Stephanie who are totally on board and supportive. So we have another meeting with the staff set up for next Tuesday, and we're going to go over, start the planning process, look at the list of the elements, what we can tackle, what the team thinks that, we could maybe do quick wins on, and what are things that we don't have a veterinarian in-house, for instance, so telemedicine is not going to look the same as it would for those organizations that actually run clinics or have vets on staff. So stuff like that. But still optimistic, and our senior leadership is supportive of the plan and excited that we're part of the pilot. So, yeah.
We are too. I'm very excited that you're part of the pilot. What are the major pushbacks that you're getting?
So what happened was I had asked Bobby if he could let me know when the press release was coming out. And we have a number of staff who follow the Maddie's Fund, newsletters and whatnot. And so the information about the press release came out. And so then there was a bit of a scramble to explain to staff, because we were on the list, if you looked hard enough. And so the main pushbacks that we're getting are, have to do with leaving the animals in the community, especially the cats. We're getting slammed currently on social media for not bringing healthy stray cats into the building. And so now we've essentially said to the team, this is something that we're going to look at continuing. And then their feeling when they look at it is that because we've spent, all our careers caring for animals in the building, that this model isn't going to include all of the team members that we currently have. And I get that. It's already a stressful time for so many people. We've been really fortunate that the city has kept on our entire team, even at reduced hours and with reduced services. but they feel like, this means that we're not going to have jobs. And one of the things that we've seen, and we're in Ontario, Canada, and certainly in the province of Ontario, and I know in the northeastern US, over the last 5 or 8 years, we've actually seen a steady decline in our population in shelter, especially from the cat standpoint. We have no idea where all the cats have gone, and it would be great if somebody could do some research on that, but they aren't in the shelter, that's for sure. And so when I pulled the stats and showed it to the team yesterday, I said, when you look at these stats from 2014 through to the end of 2019, we've had a 50% decline in the number of cats that we're housing and a 30% decline in the number of dogs. So something's got to give. We have to do something differently because we're not getting the numbers of animals in that we used to. And so if we want to keep the team together and keep doing animal services, we have to figure out what that looks like. And this is a great opportunity to look at this model. So we'll see. I was just talking to Stephanie on my way home. I just like left the office, came home to do this call. And I said, you know, I fully anticipate that there will be some people who jump right on board, some people who have to kind of hem and haw and chew on it a bit, and other people who will flat out refuse to go down the path, and we'll just have to deal with that when we get to it.
That's interesting. We haven't really talked much about staff pushback, but I imagine that that's going to be a huge hurdle for folks. And I was just thinking that for this call, I was just texting with the instructors that like maybe for this call, we can sort of pivot and make this like a place where your staff can come to and like really invite, you know, like invite people if they have questions, and it doesn't need to just be you all fielding them, or inviting some of the other tier two shelters as well.
And Stephanie, it's so funny you should say that, Rory, because Stephanie and I literally were just talking not half an hour ago about, should we let the team know about the AMPA Monday meetings? Because we've kept it all fairly quiet so far, right? And we probably spent 10 minutes, she and I, on the phone going back and forth, trying to figure out, oh, should we let them know about this? Shouldn't we let them know about it? So yeah, we're still on the fence as far as that goes, to be honest, because in the meeting we had yesterday, which included the majority of our team as well as the commissioner that I report to, staff totally attacked management. So it wasn't a good scene. It wasn't fun. And you know, I'll speak for myself, and I think Stephanie probably feels the same way, but on those calls that we have on Mondays and Fridays, that's like our family. And so I feel like if I bring these naysayers to that club, I'm just going to get trashed there too. I'm not up for that this week anyways. But I think there's I definitely think there's a place. And maybe, Stephanie, I hate to put you on the spot, but maybe she'd like to comment, because I've been coming to the AMPA calls I think since week two, maybe. And I pulled Stephanie, she's one of our registered veterinary technicians. I pulled her right out of the shelter about 4 weeks in and said, you get to work from home from now on and you get to work on this. And she had a mild panic attack or maybe more, but she's a total convert. And I think a lot of it has to do with being on these calls and seeing the enthusiasm and the passion from everybody.
Absolutely, I would just agree with that. And that is, I think it's part of the fear for us is we get so ramped up when we attend these meetings and it's so encouraging and we get so many good ideas, but we knew bringing this to staff, it's terrible, but we knew that the reaction at first was not going to be a kind one. So it's almost like we need to get them to a point where it's going to be productive, because we would hate to bring them in and have it be a negative force, if that makes sense. And I mean, part of it is I'm, as Kathy said, I'm working from home. So I'm separated from that right now. So I'm a bit out of touch with the day-to-day of what's going on in the shelter.
I feel like I've been working in the clinic at Austin Pets Alive the last few weeks, and it's been eye-opening for me to hear how staff address certain issues with people. And I feel like there's no more a passionate person than like a person in their 20s in animal welfare. Like they are just super passionate. They have very strong beliefs. And it's I think it is going to be hard to sway them. I kind of, after today's meeting, I thought to myself, why haven't we shared the Monday meeting with our staff, even like our clinic managers? So I sent it to our clinic managers and a few key people in the clinic. so that they can listen in first. And then if they feel like they want to share it with the tech staff, then they can. But I think it is worth starting to bring more people into the conversation, because so it doesn't feel so us versus them, or they feel like something secretive is going on that they don't know about. So I don't know. I'm with you guys. I do think it's time to kind of start maybe slowly bringing people in, knowing that there's going to be some pushback. And like I said, man, animal welfare workers in their 20s are super passionate people. They believe what they believe, and it's going to be a process convincing some of them.
I agree, and I think it's important to do it. I understand phasing it in, and I agree, but I am worried about, you know, if we start rolling out these changes, well, we already are, and marketing changes, and it's on the website. If there is any community pushback, you know, we kind of want our teams, internal teams, to be prepared with the facts and not feel like, why am I part of an organization that's leaving dogs out on the street, you know, or is doing something, you know, just not ethical. And so it seems like we kind of have to get ahead of it and make sure they have the education. But I get it. Change is scary.
I really like the idea of a phased approach too, because then maybe as groups, you know, as a group, we can sort of come up with how to share with staff, you know, and not have to reinvent the wheel there too. Like, we have our myths and fact sheet, but that's really meant for, you know, the public as much as it is for staff. But I think having staff have like talking points and really understand some of these major changes, like, might be super helpful. I mean, it's, I think hearing that from all of you, it's definitely like helpful for me to hear that, because it's something that, like, if you're not in that position, you might, like, I wasn't necessarily thinking about that, but of course staff.
I think it's also really important to just to be transparent. You know, when we started going into this with all of this change and I started sharing information that was coming out of it, it was like, hey, look, guys, if you want to participate, come in on this chat. You know, almost everybody works Monday mornings. So, for example, our veterinarian, when she's doing surgeries, you know, now that they're doing surgeries again, of course, they like turn it up on the speakers and all the techs are listening to the conversation, and the veterinarian is, and it's creating conversation afterwards when they're answering phones at the front desk. It's their background sound. They can also be, you know, watching what's going on. So if they're not going to tune in, then sorry. If they're not going to look at the information I presented, sorry. Like, I can't force it, but we can provide as much as possible in a lot of different forms. And so that's what we've done. And then when we meet every Wednesday morning as a team, I've created polls each week going, hey, how do you feel about this? You know, if we did more wellness, what would you want to do? Would you want to expand our pet food pantry? Is that the first? And so we looked for feedback on that. And then I go back to them with more information. One of the things was the clinics that we mentioned earlier, and we've never done it drive-through clinic. It was show up and in 2 hours we do 200 to 250 animals. So now we can't really do that because of COVID. And we did have one scheduled for Tuesday that we ended up having to cancel, but it was like, okay, so what would you guys feel comfortable with? If we do appointments every 5 minutes, then we can at least monitor that drive-through. And now we do it for a full day. We'll just close the rest of the appointments for the shelter, do it for 8 hours instead of doing Tuesday once, one 2 hour, you know, version once a month. And maybe we'll start doing it every Monday. We used to be closed on Mondays, so maybe now it can be clinic day. So we started, you know, incorporating some of this stuff. What would you guys feel comfortable with? And so, you know, if they're not going to participate in the polls and the feedback and reading this information and watching what we're giving them, then, you know, that's on them. But I also understand that they're really, really stressed with everything that's happening at the shelter and in their personal lives. So, you know, I take it with a grain of salt at this point.
I completely agree with you, Erica. I think the tiered rolling out these new ideas in tiers is going to be really helpful. No one likes change. So that slow process has always helped. But I think you're on the right track in that we have to be as transparent as possible with our teams, because nothing encourages gossip and toxicity more than a lack of information, right? People need info, and if you don't give it to them, they're going to come up with their own, and it's probably wrong. But yeah, I agree. You can present it to them. If they're not going to watch it, they're not going to join. Well, at least they can't come back on you then. You've done your job. You've tried to explain it. but I do think it's going to be critical for all of us to be as transparent as we can about these changes that are coming and then roll it out in small tiered increments to get everybody aboard.
Yeah, and I know one thing that was kind of weird for me the last week or so was talking to the staff in the clinic was now I'm the person that they won't necessarily take information from because I'm not one of them anymore. But I know that if I tell, I'm going to make up names, if I tell Clara, and I know I can sway Clara, or Clara's going to be receptive to the Monday morning phone calls, then Billy's going to listen to Clara better than he's going to listen to me. And so you can kind of start letting those people in that you know you can, that are going to be willing to listen, and then they can start those conversations with some of the other staff.
One of the things for us that's been really helpful is on our Wednesday calls, we try not to be Erica talking to the whole rest of the team. We have the other managers speak up. We have the polls, so we try to break it up. But twice a month, we try to have a guest speaker. So early on, we were able to get Amanda Arrington speaking to us about everything that Pets for Life stands for. And, you know, it forces them, because they are required to attend the meeting, to at least attend that aspect. And, you know, we had a pharmaceutical rep this week present on, you know, parasites in dog parks and the prevalence of worms and shelter dogs and that kind of thing. And it's an interesting case study, but it sort of broke it up. And maybe it wasn't completely related to saving lives, but it was more education. And, you know, we started out COVID with that. We, a lot of you probably saw the webinar on FIV and feed-loop testing. And how unreliable that can be. So we shared that with the staff, made it mandatory. They got to watch it by the end of the month. And then we had a discussion on it, you know, met on a Zoom meeting about it, and then rolled it out that we're no longer testing unless the animal's going into a foster home, or it's a life-saving measure for going into a rescue or using it as a diagnostic, but we're no longer routinely testing everything that comes in. And everybody was receptive. They had all the information and we moved forward. But that was probably a really big change for a lot of our staff. And we had to write a letter to all of the veterinarians in our town. We had to write an email to all of our volunteers, all of our foster parents. Like, it was a big undertaking, and it took us months to roll the whole thing out.
Amazing. I love hearing that. That's so cool.
Some of the pushback
letter too.
Sorry, some of the pushback we're getting the most from is not the young 20-something passionate. It's the, you know, they've worked at the shelter for 15, 20 plus years since they were 20-somethings, and they don't necessarily want to engage with new information. So they're very comfortable in their roles. And a lot of those, you know, longstanding beliefs that, for example, the dog can't leave the shelter for a sleepover because it's too stressful on them. You know, they're not willing to listen that actually, you know, information coming out is saying that break is great for the dog. So it's trying to change those longstanding, deep-seated beliefs when they're so against new information or even very disbelieving of statistics that are coming out of research.
You know, I'm only going to say one thing about this, but I think if people that aren't willing to learn new information in animal welfare, those are lives. Those are lives saved. And if you can't take in new information, that's lives that are at risk because of that. So that closed-mindedness, I firmly believe, has no place in animal welfare. Each and every one of us, I mean, and we all go through phases of getting stuck in something and having to be convinced otherwise, but to grasp onto something so tight that you can't see the benefit of the animal, because that's why we're all in this. And it's why we've all been in it, and it's why everybody got in it, because we have a passion for animals. But that type of deep-seated belief, it scares me, because that just means those are animals' lives at stake. And that's not something to mess around with.
I think you can only spend so much time arguing too. It becomes fruitless for me. Like Erica said, I'm gonna present you with the information. Here's all the science behind why we're making this change. Like, you stop testing, that's wonderful. That's where the industry is leading, but you do have those people who are gonna push, 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 and push. And for me, my position has always been, I'm gonna present you with why. and here's all the science that supports it. We made an educated decision. If you don't like it, let's talk about it. By all means, let's talk about it. But then that's how it is now. That's what the science has supported. And there's only so much time that I feel like any of us have to keep investing when you know that person's opinion is never, ever going to change. Nothing you say is ever going to change it. And for me, that's just taking time away from life-saving now. And so eventually I have to let that go. If that means I have to let you go, then that's a decision that we sometimes have to get on board with. But I think Jordana's right. There's only so long. If you're stuck on that deep-seated opinion and you will not be swayed by science of all things, which we should be able to read in a study and get on board with, then there's only so much time I feel like any of us have to keep investing in those people.
Thanks, guys. I completely agree with both Jordana and Monica. One thing that Stephanie and I didn't share with you is that because we're a municipal government, those people that are challenging our union staff, and some of them have been there for 30 years. So that is a bit of a fly in the ointment when it comes to moving them along to another area or right out the door. But I've come into that committed to taking that track where I need to. And it's so interesting. And just to give you another sense of how entrenched they are. So the staff meeting we had yesterday, I did a brief PowerPoint presentation, which included our own statistics about how the cat population has declined in the shelter and the dog population has declined. And two things came out of that. One of the other stats that I provided were the recently released stats from the City of Austin and their study related to found pets and how, you know, the majority of them are going home same day when they stay with the finder, and people aren't having to even interact with the city to find the owners of the animals. And so I got feedback from staff about, well, why are all these studies from the US? So that's an issue we have, right? Because animal welfare has never been great up until the last probably 5 or 10 years about statistics. And then the other thing I got was with respect to our own stats, you know, somebody commented on the fact that I compared all the years from 2014 to 2019. And if you look at the difference between the numbers of cats in 2014 and the number of cats in 2019, there was almost a 50% decrease. And they said, well, for 2 weeks in 2019, the shelter was closed because we had ringworm outbreak, and that's not reflected in that information. So it will be a struggle. Stephanie and I had the pleasure of speaking with Mandy Evans a few weeks ago, and Mandy explained the challenges that she had making changes in her organization. So she doesn't have quite the same issues from a unionized standpoint, but I understand Gina might be another key person to talk to about that. So looking to chat with her soon enough.
That's really good information. And we do have a union working group too. So we'll be able to feed some of those questions into that working group as well to help answer some of these questions. Cause I know that as much as unions are amazing and I'm super pro union, it can be really frustrating with big change. This has been really interesting. I'm curious, like I put in the chat a call like this one for director level, but really specifically around staff challenges that are coming up, and try to get Kristen and maybe Gina on that call as well. Do people think that would be useful? Navigating staff change.
I love listening to you all. I'm so grateful I got to come today. And truthfully, when there was this pause, I guess it was right before Kathy came on, I started to ask, how is everybody stressed at their with their staffs? I don't want to go on one of my soapboxes, but like, this is my thing. And sorry, I'm going to cry as I say this to y'all. Like, when y'all were rolling out the whole community thing, like this is my thing. And I started to put a proposal together for her and I chickened out. And I can't tell y'all. I mean, in Amarillo, Texas, an animal control officer killed himself last Thursday. I believe it was Fort Worth, Texas, 24 hours later. Suicide is something that is very tender to me. And I love, I think your name is Jordana. I'm like listening to you, like our brains are in survival mode. And that's a good thing. I mean, we needed to be there, but there's a balance to it. And I'm with a company, but we work with shelters all over the country. And my goal is when they reach out to us, I want to introduce them to the experts like you guys. But like listening to what's happening all over, you know, it's like, I want to keep people's wells filled to keep, like you were talking about, like we have to keep making change, but I can kind of only handle so much change at a time. And you know, you don't know what somebody's going through at home. Like we had one of our employees who's been with us for 20 years. She's found out there this morning, her son's dead. I mean, like, and I don't mean to be being all, but I mean, we do have to keep progressing, but we have to keep our wells filled. And so I was going to propose to her, like, and part of this whole new movement is, and this sounds stupid, but it's the self-care we have to do to keep giving back. And I mean, I get the whole save them all, but we have to restore. We have to refill our wells to keep being flexible. Because like when you have a staff member who gets their panties in a wad about something, I mean, they go to a restaurant, of course, like nowadays they're not at a restaurant, but you know, like, and they're fuming. That's how that toxicity suddenly kind of creeps into the community. Like, it's okay to be angry, but we have to disagree effectively. The stakes are so high right now. So sorry, I get, but listening to you all, I'm honored that I got to hear you all. And thank you for what you're doing. That we brought in a company to do some training with us last year, and it went better than we expected. So we were going to bring them back to train more of our staff before the pandemic hit. And then we actually started doing some recordings with them to share with animal welfare. And that's something I'm being gifted the opportunity to do, to try to kind of package this for people like Kathy. If you're in a municipal agency, you don't have $3,000 to bring in some training, because you may have a totally different staff in a month or 2 months from now. And I don't mean that disrespectfully, but like, this is really freaking hard, but so important. So sorry. Listening to y'all has been so inspiring. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Molly. And I don't think you have anything to apologize for. I appreciate you sharing with us. And I'm so sorry for all the grief that you're going through. But I'm excited. I think that everything that you said, yes. Let's solve for this, and let's make sure that we're taking care of ourselves and taking care of our people.
Yeah, and kind of going back,
listening to you. Sorry, Erica, like listening to you, the conscious effort you are making to change things, like it, to roll that program out. It took months, but that's how you create culture change. It does take months to get everybody on board, because like I can be in the conversation and it makes sense, but then I get tired and I'm home alone and I go back into my catty old stuff and suddenly I'm on the dark side again and you got to bring me back. Like part of it, I wrote listening to you, like part of that process is, I guess it was when Kathy is talking, like it's unconscious that we do it, but we all do it. It's unavoidable and it's necessary because it's part of the change. So sorry, I'll be quiet now.
Well, and I just want to add one more thing. Going back to what Monica said about if we don't communicate with staff, they're going to make up a story. And that story is almost always going to be negative. And so we have to be checking in with staff. Where are they at? How are they doing? Individually and as a group, and kind of as we bring them along on this journey, because they didn't necessarily choose it. They can choose it or they can leave it, it's up to them. But obviously we want to bring people with us. But yeah, part of that communication goes back to, you know, how are you doing? What's going on in your life this week? I see you were late 20 minutes, you know, is everything okay? Are you having car trouble? You know, even just those little questions
I think, go a long way with staff.
Totally agree. Thank you. This has been amazing, and I'm just so thankful for all of you joining us. And I'm gonna ask if everyone, if you could put your email in the chat from today, since this is such a small group, I'd really like to follow up with this particular group and just keep this conversation going next week. And bring in some of the other, either this next week or the following week, and bring in some folks from some of the other tier one and tier two shelters too, like some of the directors, so we can keep this conversation going, if that sounds good. I love how these conversations just turn like into, I don't know, just it's like, it feels like more casual, and I hope that you all enjoy them. And I know that it's a small group today, but I feel like I just learned a lot and was taking notes. And so I really appreciate everybody being here today. And we look forward to seeing you soon. Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Rory, very much for hosting. And I enjoyed the group today very much. Thanks, everybody, for all of your support and opinions and great suggestions. Have a great weekend.
Yeah, you too. Talk soon.
Bye. Bye, everyone. Thank you.